Thank you very much. I see some elected officials here. I appreciate you being here. I want to make sure that we get started on time. And this is a very important day. It's a very important topic. I appreciate all of you for being here to participate. For those from the Village Board, Oakland Mills, I see Milton from CA, very important. A lot of folks from the county here, from the state, federal government. I see a lot of our delegates over here. I see Vanessa Atterbury is here, and Frank Kittleman is here. I don't, any other elected officials I haven't seen yet? Oh, Mayor Kay, I'm sorry, Chairperson. And Kim Prime is here for Calvin Ball. But also, before I turn it over to Diane Wilson, my chief of staff, has basically been coordinating this, and so I'm going to have her kind of moderate today, but I want to make a few comments. This is certainly an issue that's been around for a while, and during the campaign, I met with a lot of folks from British Columbia and others talking about this, and the topic that just kept on coming up was funding, and how there might be a lot of dreams for something, but if you don't have the funding, you can't do it. So that's what today's all about. Today's all about us trying to sit together here and start brainstorming and talking to folks to figure out ways in which we can make this happen or something happen. So there are a lot of options on the table, but we got to make sure we know what's available before we even start planning. So that's why we're here today. I also want to thank Marsha McLaughlin, who's here, our Director of Planning and Zoning. This is her last week in her position. So Marsha, I publicly want to thank you for your time and your support. Done such a tremendous job representing Howard County for such a, I won't say how long.
A distinguished career,
that's right, Mary Kay. But I also want to introduce the gentleman who's sitting to her left, who is our new Department of Planning and Zoning Director, Val Asmus. Delegate Clarence Lamb is here as well. Thank you for coming, Clarence. I am going to go ahead and turn this over to Diane Wilson. I'm going to stay as long as I possibly can. I do have a couple other meetings this morning, but I appreciate, again, all of you being here, and I look forward to working with you on this very, very important issue. Diane, it's all yours.
Thank you. Hello, everyone, and welcome. This is an exciting day for all of us, especially the British Columbia folks who've been here working on this issue a long time. And we have a number of Village Board members from Oakland Mills and from Town Center. Welcome. This certainly impacts everything that you are working on. So just a couple of things, housekeeping issues. We are recording the program this morning. And as you're speaking at the tables, you will need to take the mic and move it over close to you to speak into the mic. We only had 9 mics, so our apologies. So if you're going to speak, move the mic over so it can be recorded properly. So it's going to be an informal. We certainly have a number of presentations. This around 11 o'clock or so, we'll have an informal discussion. You'll see on the agenda the discussion points. I'm certain there'll be questions, and as I said, this is to be informal and informative. Our goal today is to really find out what kinds of funds are available for the British Columbia or another type of bridge. It's all on the table. So we're certainly here to get a lot of good information. I also wanted to recognize and welcome Milt Matthews, President of CA. We're happy to have CA here as partner as well. Without further ado, Fred Gottmuller is going to start the discussion. He's going to be our first presenter. And Fred is an engineer and an architect who specializes in the aesthetic aspects of bridges. I'm not going to read his entire bio, but his prize-winning projects include the Woodrow Wilson Bridge over the Potomac River in Washington, D.C., as well as crossings of World Heritage Site, two National Wild Scenic Rivers, and bridges crossing the Mississippi, the Missouri, the Ohio. So suffice to say, Fred is an expert. He's been a resident of Columbia since 1969 and currently lives in Town Center Village. So we welcome Fred.
Thank you, Diane. Good morning, everybody.
Good morning.
I'd like to start by explaining what that symbol is on the left side of the slide for those of you who may not be familiar with it. That's actually a silhouette of the people tree, which is a sculpture that sits in the center of Columbia. It is a reminder that Columbia is a new town. It started off in the 1960s with 15,000 acres of empty farmland. And now we have 100,000 people here, more plus, living and working here, organized into 9 villages in the downtown. We have a community college with more than 30,000 students. We've got a regional hospital. And all of that is divided into two halves by Route 29. So let's go to the next slide. What is Bridge Columbia? It's a pedestrian, bicycle, and transit bridge over US 29. And its goal is to create a multimodal urban corridor connecting major Columbia destinations. And with 100,000 people, we now have enough density here to have transit service for those destinations. It uses existing transit rights of way that are owned by the Columbia Association. 50-foot wide rights of way, 17 miles of them that go through the city, serve many of the village centers in the downtown. And that would provide a potential nucleus for express rapid transit bus system, something that's kind of now a buzzword in the transit field, but something that we already have a foundation for if we wanted to use it. And we also would use the opportunity to create an iconic structure on US 29 that would announce that Columbia's here and innovation still has a home in Columbia and Howard County and in Maryland. So here's the urban corridor. A lot of those destinations I mentioned line up along the corridor, starting in the west with the community college and the hospital just off the slide to the left. Continue through Wild Lake, through the downtown, past the Columbia Mall, crosses US 29 on what we hope will be Bridge Columbia, and then continue east of 29 on to Oakland Mills Village Center, to Blandair Park, a huge investment the county's put in east of 29, and then on to Long Ridge and the Columbia Gateway. So that's the urban corridor. This is the rights of way that are out there on the ground, 17 miles of them, connecting most of the early village centers, 50 feet wide, and for the most part unoccupied today, but still available for use for buses. What we had proposed, this is just a sketch, a concept of what this could look like, but the idea is to have something that's an icon that people will recognize to be a memorable symbol of Columbia. You know, as you go up and down 29 right now, the only thing you see are these green signs that say, Columbia, get off here. Well, there ought to be more. There ought to be something that says that this is a special place. We have to remember that we're in competition with places like Arlington and Bethesda for millennials or empty nesters, economically productive people who don't want to depend on a car, want a different lifestyle, and we don't have much to offer. So this is an opportunity to give them something. Why do we need Bridge Columbia? Well, we decided to answer that question by using the criteria that the Federal Transit Administration uses to evaluate what makes a community an attractive place to live. So it starts off with provide more transportation choices. Bridge Columbia all by itself would create mobility throughout Columbia for pedestrians, bikers, and transit users. If you look at what we've got today, many people consider it unsafe. Many people won't use it. It doesn't meet current ADA standards. It doesn't even meet Howard County bicycle standards or the state of Maryland's bicycle standards. It's too narrow. And it is literally the only pedestrian bicycle crossing of US 29 in Columbia. And there are something like 45 miles of pedestrian bicycle trails in Columbia on west of 29 and another 45 miles east of 29, and the only thing connecting them is this bridge. So, if more people were willing to use it, they could get from Oakland Mills to downtown in less time than it takes some people who live in downtown to get to the mall. It's even better if you're riding a bus. You could get there across the bridge on a bus in 2 minutes. Right now it takes 10 minutes to go by way of Brooklyn Parkway and 15 minutes to go by way of 175. And partially that's the distance, but partially that's because you're spending time sitting in traffic and waiting for stoplights. So, next slide. If you think about our existing transit system, 5 of the 9 Howard County routes cross 29. It's about 65 trips a day. They run on an hour headway, so if we got to a half hour headway, or better yet, which is what it should be, a 15-minute headway, that number would double or quadruple. Well, if you can save 10 to 15 minutes per trip, over 65 trips or 130 trips or more, pretty soon you're talking about real time savings, which means real money savings. And so that's where British Columbia could really make a contribution to transit in Howard County. I've shown a 6th line here as the green line, which does not cross 29 today, but which should. It's going to be the nucleus of a downtown circulator. If it crossed 29 as a circulator, it would pull Oakland Mills into the orbit of downtown. It would become almost like a neighborhood of downtown and go a long way towards ensuring its success as a redevelopment. So that brings us to the economic competitiveness. If you can get from Oakland Mills to downtown in 2 minutes, why would you ever take a car? And if you don't take a car, it doesn't have to be parked in downtown. We don't have as much congestion downtown. All the things that make the redevelopment of downtown, and we're talking about another 5,500 residential units, another 2 million square feet of commercial space, all the things that densify downtown, that create potential congestion issues, would be reduced. If we had this kind of a symbol on 29, it would be more visibility for Columbia, would mean more interest for Columbia as a place to live and work, and bring more people both to Columbia and to the county. And we would also support existing communities. The Oakland Mills Village Board has talked to a lot of different developers who might be interested in redeveloping Oakland Mills, and they've all said that better transit service to and a better transit connection to Oakland Mills is necessary for the redevelopment of Oakland Mills. It also would make possible improved transit service to Long Reach and other communities. To the right of this map that could benefit from improved transit service. Finally, we'd reduce air pollution and support the kind of open streets movement that the Horizon Foundation is promoting. We're trying to make better use of our streets by more modes than just automobiles. You know, and air pollution and energy consumption is something like a day like today we really should be thinking about. So it coordinates and brings together policies and leverages investments, including a significant county investments in downtown, the Inner Arbor, Oakland Mills, Blandair Park, and Long Reach. Would support the Howard Community College. You wouldn't have to build as many parking spaces there. And it provides a symbol of Howard County as an innovative community determined to live in the 21st century. So what about funding? Well, we think it would cost somewhere between $10 and $15 million. The county has done a feasibility study which thinks it will cost between $15 and $37 million. We have some problems with those numbers, but we'll get into those later. In any case, it's going to take multiple funding sources. It's going to have to come from a couple of different pots. One of the pots we're really interested in, we think could be a good possibility, would be federal or state transit funding. Another possibility would be federal or state bicycle funds. So there are other options out there. We hope we can be creative in finding how to combine them. And that's what we hope to learn more about later this morning. We'll hope to come away from this with that kind of information. So I'd like to close by showing a couple of examples of other projects of similar type. And the first one is a project in Eugene, Oregon. It's almost exactly the same length as what we're talking about, almost exactly the same spans over a major highway. It had similar environmental issues. It's in open space, it's got wetlands, a water crossing, all the things that we would have to grapple with here in British Columbia. They were able to build it for a little less than $4 million and in about 2.5 years, starting from the same point we're at today with British Columbia. It's not, it doesn't carry transit, so you'd have to widen it by about a factor of three. But if you took that $4 million and multiplied it by three, it would be $12 million. So you're in the ballpark. Now, it's not quite that simple, but at least it's in the ballpark of the $15 million that we're talking about. And the last example I'd like to show is a much larger bridge also in Oregon that combines pedestrians, bicycles, and transit, but not other vehicles. So that's a new idea, but that's starting to have currency in the transportation field. And if you think about it, it makes sense. You know, every bus trip starts with a walk or a bicycle ride. Every bicycle ride starts with a walk, sometimes with the bicycle on the bus. It makes sense for those modes to be together. They don't interfere with each other in the same way that highway vehicles interfere with bus or pedestrian or bicycle travel. And so it frees up the three modes we're talking about from the kind of competition from cars and trucks that they would get in a normal bridge. So that concludes our presentation this morning. We've got a little handout we'd like to distribute now to give you some more facts and figures. There may be some more questions. There's going to be a question and answer session a little bit later this morning. We'll try to answer the questions then. And I also wanted to announce that every year we put on a bridge walk on the 4th of July, which is a time when we are on the bridge and greet people going across to watch the fireworks downtown. And we'd like to invite you all to come. And if you get there early enough, we hand out free glow sticks. So we hope to see you there. Thank you.
Thanks, Fred. That was great. We saw a couple other people come in the room. Delegate Turner is here. Welcome. Karen Knight is here for Council Member Greg Fox. So we welcome her as well. Now we have a presentation by Deputy Secretary Schrader, who's here from Maryland Department of Transportation with his team. We welcome y'all. We're grateful to have Dennis here. He's been a member of Howard County, Columbia for many, many years. So welcome.
Thank you. Good morning, everybody, and welcome to all the elected officials here.
Thank you. Can you raise the mic a little bit?
Okay, very good.
Thank
you. All right. So, wanted to thank all the elected officials for being here today, and County Executive Kittleman for asking us to come and be part of this. On behalf of Pete Ron, our secretary, it's a privilege to be here representing him. For those of you who haven't met Pete, he goes by Pete, and I go by Dennis, so we like to be informal, and we talk to the staff the same way. So please do that. But Pete was secretary in New Mexico, and he was also secretary in Missouri, and is a national leader in the transportation field, particularly with organizations like the American Association of Highway and Transportation Executives. So we're very lucky to have him, and it's great to work with him. So Don Halligan, who's with me here, is the Director of Planning and Capital Programming for MDOT, and we've also got Kevin Quinn, who's the Director of Planning for MDOT's Transportation Administration. Kevin will be available during the Q&A. Don is going to give us a presentation, but let me just quickly set the context for why we think we're here. Hopefully we've hit the mark. But basically, Maryland has the Transportation Trust Fund, which the voters in the last election said loud and clear they wanted a lockbox on that fund, and we are responsible to the governor and the legislature for making sure that we honor that. On an annual basis, we probably spend about $2.5 billion in capital. That sounds like a tremendous amount of money. It is a tremendous amount of money. I tell people on my staff, every time they talk about a project, it's $50 million. Well, I've never been in a room with $50 million, quite frankly, so I'm not quite sure how tall that is. But, you know, anything you start to talk about costs a lot of money. But $2.5 billion, but let me set the context for that $2.5 billion. If you took all the priority letters of all the local jurisdictions around the state, that would add up to about $75 billion, just the priority letters, okay? And on top of that, we have the six modes where we have to do, you know, the system planning for intermodal. We got the port, the airport, we've got the transit administration, the highways. The toll authority has its own money, so it's not in the trust fund. They operate based on the tolls. But everything else within MDOT comes out of that transportation trust fund. So it's the $75 billion from the local priority letters plus all of the planning that goes into the systems. So today what we're going to talk about, and normally we do an annual tour. We go to every major jurisdiction in the state, secretary, and we tell you about what, and that usually happens in the fall, we tell you about what's in the consolidated transportation program for that jurisdiction. What we're going to talk about today in Don's presentation is how does the sausage get made? And for anybody who's been around sausage making, it's not all that pleasant, but it is a process. And our challenge is to make sure that there's a rational, defensible process. Because if you have $2.5 billion that you're going to put into an annual budget and about $15 billion in the six-year consolidated transportation program, you have to be able to explain why. And we're always doing that, and as we should. Right now we're in the process, over the summer we'll be putting together the next year's six-year program. That'll go to the governor later in the summer, and then that'll be presented to the legislature in the next legislative cycle. So, just wanted to set that context, and the way I'd like to describe it, and Don will go through this in some detail, it's really a three-dimensional puzzle. If you're playing these three-dimensional chess, you have the multimodal network that I talked about, and then you have regional coordination, and we're actually working on a major regional coordination project here in Howard County, where you've got Prince George's County, Howard County, and Anne Arundel County down in Laurel Park, and there's a large development there that has major implications for highway network, for transit, and we're looking very carefully at that. And one of the things that Pete's very concerned about is making sure that we get out in front of these things and focus on them. And that one's been laying around for 4 or 5 years apparently. So we're stepping up and driving that on a regional basis to make sure there's transparency and focus on all the implications. So that's an idea of a regional issue that's affecting you all in this room. And then lastly, we have local priorities and local initiatives. You have the zoning authority, you decide what your priorities are, and you determine where you want your community to go. So it's a partnership, but it's a very complex one, and you're gonna hear from Don about the mechanics of how that works. So I'm gonna turn it over to Don, and then Kevin and I, Don, will be available for questions. Thank you, go ahead, Don.
Thank you. Good morning.
Good morning.
I'm Don Halligan, Director of the Office of Planning and Capital Programming at the Maryland Department of Transportation. It's a pleasure to be here this morning. And as Dennis mentioned, I'm going to start by talking about who we are, what we do, how we do what we do, and some of the processes and considerations we assume when we build the capital program. So I'm going to talk about MDOT structure. Many of you may know about it. My apologies to Marcia and John. You probably heard me say this before, talk about MDOT. But many people don't really understand how we're structured and how we interrelate. I'm going to talk about some of our key products, like our state report on transportation that we provide to the General Assembly every year. I'm going to talk about the planning process and our funding, of course. So, MDOT structure is like you see on the display. I'm in the secretary's office. I run the planning shop. We do system level planning, broad brush planning, capital programming for the department. We have five modes: the Aviation Administration that owns and operates BWI, Thurgood Marshall Airport, Martin State Airport, and funds 37 other airports around the state. MDOT is the Maryland Port Administration that owns and operates portions of the port, is the principal steward for port operations. MDOT is also the Maryland Transit Administration that owns and operates the Baltimore network in the Baltimore region and funds locally operated transit systems throughout the state. And that's also the Motor Vehicle Administration, where we do licensing and registration services across the state. And we're the State Highway Administration that owns and operates 17,000 miles of the highest functioning roads in the state. Some of our key products that we produce these every year, or we provide these to the General Assembly every year. Is our state report on transportation, and it's actually three separate documents. The Maryland Transportation Plan, we do that every 4 years. We do the capital budget, which is our shorter term plan. It's a 6-year capital program rolling budget document. And our annual attainment report, which links our plan and our budget by performance metrics, looking at or describing how we're doing with our investments and meeting our goals of our transportation plan. I happen to bring some of these documents if you're interested, come see me. This is Maryland Transportation Plan. We did it last year in January 14th, 2014. This is our annual attainment report. And this is our capital budget. Planning happens on many different levels, and transportation planning does as well as general planning. It functions at the state level, it functions at the regional level, and at the local level. So, at the state, we do it at MDOT. In this region, it's the Baltimore Metropolitan Council staffs, the Baltimore Regional Transportation Board. That's the Metropolitan Planning Organization that does a 20-year plan for the region that Howard County is a part of. It, of course, happens at the local level where the local governments are doing transportation planning. The statewide plan has a vision and a mission. It's up there. I'm not going to read it for you, but it's up there. We have six goals: safety and security, economic prosperity, system preservation, quality of service, environmental stewardship, and community vitality. And the plan really, yeah, the plan is intended to really help us set a strategic context for discussions that we have with the regional and local governments and the federal government. And provide a sounding board and set expectations and hold us accountable. So the regional planning process occurs, as I mentioned, at the metropolitan planning level in the planning organizations. They are a federal creature, actually, so if we use and we do utilize federal aid, these that go through the metropolitan planning organization. They're designated for all urbanized areas in the state, Baltimore, again, you're in the Baltimore region here. That federal funding needs to be facilitated through a continuing cooperative comprehensive process that the metropolitan planning organizations run. They call that the 3C process. And as I mentioned, they develop a plan, a long-range plan, and several other key documents, a budget document as well. There are 7 of these MPOs throughout the state. We have, my apologies to, I think folks in the background can't see, read this map, but we have 7 MPOs in the state, Wilmington, so Cecil County, Maryland, and Newcastle County, Delaware are an MPO that we're a part of, Baltimore, Washington, Washington Council of Governments, Salisbury, Hagerstown, Cumberland, and our newest one is in Southern Maryland, around Lexington Park. I mentioned their long-range plan. Their long-range plan, they call the CLRP, that serves as a vision for the region. It is fiscally constrained, meaning that when you develop the plan and the projects within the plan, you have to have a reasonable assumption of what projects, where the funding is coming from those projects, or it can't be in the plan. In addition to the projects that we fund through the CTP and through the state, there are local, regionally significant projects. These are usually larger order local projects that are included. They come from your local comprehensive plans or your capital budgets. Important to us at the local level is what we call the priority letters. These are letters that we receive from local governments annually throughout the state. We have received Howard County's most recent one was back in April this year. These represent the county's internal ranking of what they feel is important for the state to be considered to do and to take on. There are a wide variety of projects that usually occur. We have highways, transit, and bike and ped, usually. For some reason, we don't normally get projects for the Motor Vehicle Administration or the Port Administration. Talk a minute about state funding. Dennis mentioned the Transportation Trust Fund. That is our source of state funding, where all our funding flows. We'll get a little deeper into that in a second. It allows us that structure allows us to direct resources to priority projects. And really be strategic in our allocation of our resources. The last bullet there really is about the authority. Many people don't understand that the Transportation Authority's funding isn't really part of the trust fund. It's their projects are funded separately out of toll revenue from the toll facilities themselves. a little bit more about the trust fund. It's made up of several sources: motor vehicle fuel taxing, titling taxing, operating revenues, bonds. We get a small portion of the income tax. We get federal aid and registration fees and other motor vehicle fees goes into the fund and is then doled out to the mobile administrations that we need. And it's doled out through our capital budget, our consolidated transportation program. We call it the consolidated transportation program because it is a consolidated trust fund of many revenue sources. It's, as I mentioned, it's a fiscally constrained document over 6 years. It's a six-year rolling budget. For any project that we do, it's got to appear in our capital budget, and it will appear there. Those documents are online if you're interested in looking at them, or if you'd like a copy and want to hold your doors open or something, we can make that happen too. Dennis mentioned that we go out on the tours every fall. So this fall, starting in September, we'll be coming out to each and every county in the state. We meet with the elected officials and citizens and talk about what we are planning to do and listen to their concerns. Again, we do that every year. I encourage you to come. The process really is robust, and the projects that enter the CTP have to usually go through, if they're locally generated, they come from us through the priority letters. We have conversations about what that project is and scope it. And then if funding can be found, it enters into the program. These are some of the priorities that we consider when we build our program. So when and if a project gets funded, gets state funding, we consider, creating economic development and jobs? Is it improving our system? Is it innovative in its financing? Is it encouraging some public policy that we're trying to encourage, like transit-oriented development or alternative travel? Is it addressing environment? Does it make our system more safe and secure? Or is it addressing a specific problem like freight? Here are some of our general criteria that we consider when we're thinking about funding a project. Is it required? Is it a legal mandate? Are we required to do it by the federal government or the state government? Does it support other program priorities that I mentioned before? Does it maximize our federal aid? Does it match our federal aid? Doesn't support existing commitments we may have and agreements we may have. Is it a priority of the local government? Is it consistent with their local plans? Is it within an MPO's plan? So our trust fund breaks, our current trust fund breaks down this way. We've got about 20% of funding from the fuel tax, 20% of that from federal, also from another 20% from federal aid, 16% from titling, 14% from registration and other fees, 11% from bonds. We get about 50% of the total from fuel tax. taxes, title taxes, and fees, registration fees. So of that 20%, I want to talk a minute about federal aid. It's an important 20%. It's a complicated 20% to deal with. We have to go through the FEOP process. We have to, there are an awful lot of strings attached to federal aid. Our six-year budget assumes a level funding from the government, from federal government, but we've been living on a series of short-term fixes from the feds. You may have heard that the Federal Highway Trust Fund is going broke. They've been limping along for a number of years on these short-term fixes. It's hard to plan when you don't have a consistent funding source. As the county executive started off, you can't do anything if you don't know where your funding is coming from. We've had to assume a level funding, and we do assume it for the next 6 years from the federal government, but it's a big unknown. The majority of our federal aid is programmed in our six-year CTP toward projects that we've already committed to. So that assumes a level funding that we've already committed to that funding for on existing projects in the CTP. There are some discretionary grants that are available from time to time through the federal government. Probably one to keep your eye on for this project would be the Tiger Fund. Most recent rounds have been for construction projects, not for planning, but for constructing a project. That's probably the biggest source, the biggest pot that I would suggest to you would be discretionary funding that would be maybe available for such a project as this. Some of the other products, our attainment report, it's a book of our measuring our performance throughout the year, how we've done with our investments, and how we're what the outlook looks like. We do a STIP, which is a combination of the regional budgets from the metropolitan planning organizations and our CTP, so local, regionally significant projects throughout the state that are federally funded, and state projects that are federally funded going to our STIP. This is really a federal document. It's a product, it's an important product for us to produce to be able to be eligible for federal aid. This is a graphic that I wasn't sure how the room was going to be set up, so again, apologies to the folks over there. Probably can't see this, but it talks about how our transportation plan, how our long-range plan, and the various things like the county's priority letter, our highway needs inventory, our modal plans, our authority projects, and a lot of projects kind of interrelate to feed into our capital budget that we build every year. We put out a draft again in the fall, take that on tour, and we develop a final for the General Assembly in January each year. Another probably bad document or graphic to see is our timeline. I think I'm just going to miss that one. But I want to thank you. I'm available for questions if folks have questions. Thanks for your time.
Why don't you put it there? Why don't you go up there? Come on. We'll come up there.
You said that one of your very top criteria for suggesting a project is economic development. What is the most effective way for us to document the economic development of a process? What are you looking for when you're looking for making the case for economic development?
We are jobs is certainly a measure, generating jobs. But we are fairly reasonably flexible in how you do that and how you define that. Typically, what it is, the way we've thought about it in the past has been through some sort of market research that demonstrates what returns, economic returns to the state and local governments are, what jobs are generated, that sort of thing.
What about the redevelopment aspect? If you're an old community that's looking to redevelop, is that important?
Yeah, that's a great point. We also rely heavily on the local jurisdictions to tell us what they're thinking. So, for example, we're meeting on Friday down at Prince George's Plaza, and they've got the Prince George's Plaza Metro stop there. And across the street, they have a lot of development, and they have East-West Highway. Pardon my back over here, by the way. I'm sorry. So they've got East-West Highway. So we're going to go down there and meet with them, and we're going to talk a little bit about that because they have an initiative. And again, this is local initiative. So we rely heavily on local initiative. Up in Hartford County, they've got a project for the Walmart. And then a lot of times, you'll get developers who are pushing it because theoretically, developers know best about what's going on in the marketplace. And so they push projects. Paragon Outlets is pushing a project in Baltimore County. So between local initiative, and then of course, we were out, we met the county executive and Howard Hughes in downtown Columbia as a priority. So we know that that's an economic development priority here in Howard County. So we rely heavily on the local initiative to help define. Now obviously, we've got DBED, which is, you know, the FBI building over at Greenbelt and Landover are two sites that GSA is looking at. That is another opportunity. So I'd say it's coming from either local initiative or DBED input into the process. I hope that answers your question.
My question has to do with the discretionary grant program and specifically the TIGER program that you talked about. Is that program somehow tied into the regional planning and the state planning, or is that local planning where the county goes directly to the federal government requesting, competing for the funding with other areas?
It's actually both. We've applied for TIGER money in the past. But let me back up. The USDOT offers these monies occasionally. Last year, when Congress appropriates money, last year Congress appropriated some money to for the USDOT to use about $600 million across the country was made available for construction projects. That is an open call for interest, and we work with local governments. We work internally to try and find out projects that might apply and might fit. We also work with local governments to define where these projects might happen. In the past, they've done planning, so they've allowed for planning work, engineering work, but this time was only just construction. So, and it's very competitive, as you might imagine. $600 million, again, sounds like a lot of money, but when you break it up over 50 states, it doesn't go very far. Senator?
Do you know that the average size of the grants were given out for that?
For TIGER?
For TIGER, for last round?
Yeah,
it's around 10 million.
Do you know how many applicants there were?
It's always oversubscribed. I don't know what it was this last time. But we can find that out if you're interested.
Curious.
Could you remind me that the State Highway Department's role in this project in general would be construction of the bridge? And you wouldn't be involved in the operating the transit part of it, and
that's two. And the third question is, in constructing the bridge, I know there is an agreement between the counties and the state where the county puts in so much money, that makes a difference in whether you can have a prevailing wage or not. And could you just remind me as to how that works?
Right. Let me start by setting the context for that question, because there's a larger frame around that. One of the things that Pete is really focused on, and we're spending a lot of time starting to digest, is what's the hydraulic between operating and capital? Because when it goes into the trust fund, it's fungible. And therefore, we are noticing a rise in operating costs. So you probably see in the press, we're putting a lot of pressure on the bottom to, you know, start to contain their costs. And this is just so you understand the hydraulic. If WMATA's costs go up, it affects everybody in this room, because that starts to crowd out the capital. So that's issue number one. Issue number two is the other thing Pete is concerned about, and we're going to be working on this, and we started already, but it's a high priority, is beginning to focus on the integration of the modes at MDOT. Unfortunately, they've tended to operate too independently. And if you're going to do multimodal planning, so for example, I've come across, and part of what I've been doing with the team is due diligence on a whole host of projects, asking a lot of questions. So to give you an example, on the Eastern Shore, we've learned that the short line rail on the Eastern Shore is deteriorating. Well, I started asking, well, what are we going to do about that? And there was no sponsor for that within MDOT, because we haven't done a good job of multimodal planning. So we're now starting to focus on how do you sponsor that. So SHA is going to be brought in more tightly so that we get this kind of multimodal thinking with transit and the other modes, because of the trust fund being so integrated. And the fact that if one mode is doing something that's maybe not most efficient, it's going to affect the other modes. So I just wanted to set that context. So go ahead and ask three questions. Let me give you the second question again. You were asking about State Highway.
If State Highway would have any involvement in the operating of the system, or it's just going to be Howard County's transit system, buses going back and forth.
Well, SHA would, I mean,
I'm sorry,
Transit Administration. Yeah, there's a debate about that, and I know John Powell has talked to us about this, is what is the role of the lots? And I'll let Kevin step up to add some detail to this. But, MTA has a focus up in the Baltimore area, and then we fund the locally operated transit services, which operate fairly independently. But they come to the Transit Administration for grant money. So Kevin, maybe you could add something to that.
Yeah, sure. I mean, Dennis hit pretty right on. I mean, so MTA operates our core service in the Baltimore region. We also are sort of a pass-through for Federal Transit Administration dollars to the locally operated transit systems that operate throughout the state for both operating and capital dollars. I think a big piece for us is being sure that to get to Dennis's point again, sort of operating versus capital, that any capital expenditure has the associated operating costs within that budget. So for example, a local operator asks for 10 buses. Well, we have a sort of obligation to ask, are there operating funds to operate those 10 buses? And so I think for any capital expenditure that comes through our application process for federal dollars, we would look for associated sort of an operating request as well that sort of corresponds with that capital request.
And just one final question, Dennis, that what you said resonated with me. You showed the chart of the income to the trust fund, but not the where it goes. And my recollection from a number of years ago is that the more than 50% of the trust fund goes to transit in some form or another. I wondered if you had the breakdown for now, and if that's something that you're...
That's a great question. It's always tough. This room is full of former transportation executives. I think Paul's in the back there, Mr. Brookmoney. So that's a great question. We are looking carefully at that for other reasons, because there's some other projects in the pipeline that are driving that question. But right now, on the capital side, you know, we've got, it's a close 50-50, and what we want to do is get that number up. And where's the highway? Yeah, we'll figure it out. But we've looked at, what happened was that the highway number dropped significantly because of the 09 recession, and because the operating costs of the transit started driving that up. We're looking at rebalancing that, but the goal is to get back to, I think the historical number was, and these guys will have to correct, it was somewhere over 50% for highways, and about 47%, yeah, 45% for highway. And where's the number for transit? Because it includes WMATA and transit, 41%, right. So 45 to 41. So, but that goes back and forth depending on the situation. And, you know, obviously the governor is very concerned about that balance, and he's been asking a lot of questions about where the mix is. But Pete's concern, and this is another issue, is that our project delivery method too expensive? So what he's done nationally with a concept called practical design, how do you do it faster, cheaper? So for example, he's telling SHA, we'd ask them, what's your contingency for projects, and they'll say 8%. They'll say, great, now it's 2%. Because his thinking is that if we give you more money for contingency, you're just going to spend it. So, and when you start looking at a $1.2 billion capital program for SHA, that's a lot of money. So we're looking at those ratios. They're pretty close between transit and highway, and they've gone back and forth. But we're also looking at getting more out of the money that we're spending based on the delivery methodology, and that's going to be a major focus for the next few years. Delegate Turner. Oh, and a little bit, sorry. Yes. You go ahead.
Okay. Well, good morning. Thanks for being here. Dennis, good to see you. So I've been sitting listening, and this is something that's been a concern of mine over time, and this is not the first time I've raised it, but I'm going to raise it to you all as the new administration. We here in Columbia sit in a not unique but unusual, there are a couple of other jurisdictions that I can think of like us, where we are directly between two of the major regional areas that receive federal funding. Right, and so at the moment we're tied to the Baltimore Regional Council. Our funding comes through Baltimore, yet we are staring at a significant portion of our population leaving here and going south, as well as people who live south coming here for the job potential. And as we look at funding, what I really wanted to know or to advocate for, or whatever, I don't know how we do this, is how in fact does Howard County get paid attention to in both areas, right? Because Baltimore has priorities and we fit into that, and DC, the DC region has priorities and we don't, yet we're staring at the possibility of a BRT. Right, Montgomery making a choice that would logically come into Howard, but how do we access that? And when I think then about BRT coming up 29, then we start talking about the value of being able to move people across 29 to a transit center. And so then we have folks coming up 29, then can we bring people? We know we bring people out of Baltimore because that's an important connection. And so I'm stating perhaps the obvious, but when it comes to dealing with the feds, I think we depend on you to help us negotiate this. And so is Annapolis, you know, are Annapolis, I think, is similar to us in that they deal with people going north to Baltimore and also, you know, southwest to DC. And so we sit with at least a few of us on these edges where the edges, when being hard, are difficult for us to negotiate. And is there some way to soften that? Or is there some way for us to move from one region to another, based on what's more advantageous for us as a community?
Well, I'll let Don address that, but let me just, because I'm we're just starting to get into understanding the dynamic between the two MPOs.
Mm-hmm.
But I will say, and I always have to be careful because being from Howard County, I don't want to be sure that I don't become if I start spending 25% of
Well, this is why I mentioned Annapolis too.
But one of the reasons, when I was in the Navy, one of the reasons I moved to Howard County is because I wanted to be in the reserves in D.C. and I wanted to commute to Baltimore. So, and I always found problems, you know, we had commuter bus, but of course, and I've told these guys, they haven't heard this, I was really annoyed when I couldn't walk across the bridge over 32 to walk there in the morning. So, and those are issues. You're exactly right, we're caught in between. And I've taken the Metro for years down in D.C., and I have to drive down Route 1 to get to College Park, park my car, and go down. There's no easy way to get in and out of D.C. By Metro. So I'm asking those questions myself. There's no simple answer, but you know, Howard County is caught between those two MPOs, and you know, we're gonna have to be creative about balancing that. But Don, you want to make some comments? You're the MPO expert here.
Sure. I guess I'd say that in terms of the planning process, the WASHCOG, the TPB, Transportation Planning Board in the Washington region, and the Baltimore Regional Transportation Planning Board, Regional Transportation Board, do coordinate in terms of planning activities, and they do think about certainly what Howard County needs are. And I know John has been spending the past several years there as a very vocal advocate for what Howard County needs in the Baltimore region. I know the staffs talk frequently, their models, so the way they integrate their data do cover Howard County in the Washington region as they do in the Baltimore region, they have to. So in terms of the planning process, Howard County is covered. I think your question is more about how do you kind of position yourself to take advantage of any funding that might be available.
Well, that's what we're here for today,
yeah,
right?
These bodies are established by, actually they're designated by the census based upon socioeconomic demographic data, and where the largest market you're headed towards. So in 2010, they reconfirmed that Howard County was still mostly oriented toward the Baltimore region, economically, socially.
Let me ask you another question, because one of my concerns, you know, the MPO is, and this is just my simple-minded understanding of this, is that the MPOs are a consensus group that come together around regional priorities, and that feeds into the federal process, and it's a requirement of the federal process. But I think we also, and Don, you can kick me if I say something wrong here, but in my view, you know, we in our planning process need to focus on the network, which, you know, integrates the two, okay, and the local priorities of trying to understand what the issues are. So I would not put our destiny in the hands of the MPOs, quite frankly. I think we need to be aggressive about how we plan together.
Right, and I think that the reason I asked you and the reason I'm an advocate for my community in relation to the new administration at, you know, the state level is, in fact, what are our opportunities for working with the state to be able to impact our community positively. Because although the census may have told you that most people, or that we are more directed toward Baltimore, my question would be, well, how much more? Because where I live and the economic studies that we have most recently done, especially when we did our general plan, show basically in terms of where people work, we've got one third, one third, one third. All right, so it may be this much that moves us to Baltimore, and I think there, like I said, we're not unique, although we are unusual.
Right.
And how can we and others who are in similar situation to us work with you to be able to impact the work or impact what federal dollars and resources can come to the community.
Well, that's a great question. I think this forum is an example of how we can begin to have a conversation about what your needs are. We do have ongoing conversations with the county government here at the MPOs and outside of the MPO process. We have a regular, our district engineer, for instance, I know meets with DPW here all the time. There are a lot of ways to reach out, and this forum is one example.
I'll make one last comment, and then we're going to turn it over to Delegate Turner. Mary Kay, is that the other issue here is that Howard County, I've said this a few times, has the planning for Columbia for years and years and years was really the Rouse Company. And what the county needs to do now is to shift its focus. And, Marcia's done a phenomenal job, and she and I worked on the redevelopment of the North Wall area going back 20 years ago. But the focus around how that evolves is going to be really important. So I'll leave it there. I'm sorry, Bill, it's your turn.
No problem. I guess after being the flow leader on the transportation project on the 2013, the bill, I guess a lot of things that have been said today concern me, I guess, because, we all recognize the federal government no longer is going to do this long-term planning like they used to. It just hasn't happened in years. So that puts a burden on the state. So the state's going to have to fund a lot of these projects that they used to get a lot of money from the federal government that they don't get anymore. Would we all agree on that? Do you agree with that? Okay. So now we're at a point of doing a lot of these projects at the state and local level, which is going to put a tremendous burden on the state to have to keep up with these projects. And we know that we do a lot of road projects, a lot of non-road projects, transit projects, and we pretty much have a split on that money. Now, up to passing that bill, the only money we had was basically for maintenance. I mean, we didn't have and support the systems that we had going on. So now we're at the point of looking at the CTTP. But that's already set for 6 years. Is that, we all agree with that, right? We're not going to modify that. It's a rolling. It's set for 6 years, and you pretty much roll it every year. So if we were to even do this project, we'd have to be in the year seven. Would you agree? If we could make a priority now, we'd have to do it in year seven. That we're not going to bump all the other Howard County projects to push this one at the top. Would we agree with that? That's one question.
That's right.
Okay.
And in that out year, bear in mind that a lot of the projects that we have in our program are not all construction projects. They may be engineering. They may be right of way. There are these various phases that we have to fund, and not all those phases are funded. So in that out year, there may be a call for us to fund another phase of a project that we have not yet funded.
Right. So, since we're talking about funding, that seems to be the most important issue. We already checked with Annapolis on funds while you were having a discussion. And we can't seem to get this project in the capital project. So we can't fund it that way. So that's one way we can't fund it. The only other three things is possibly the Tiger grants, which we've already mentioned, which is very competitive. We want to know the numbers on how competitive. If there are 100 people applying for 6 grants, it's going to make it even tougher. We either have to do county funding, and then if we do county funding, we're going to have to do it over a course of multiple years, because I don't think he wants to put $30 million in 1 year. But it could be done, correct? It could be done over. We can start that next year if we did it that way. We can start by doing the planning money, by starting, putting some construction money in for next year. But you don't want to spread it out too long, because you want this project to go on forever. And the other possibility is a supplemental budget, because that's the governor's going to have to decide on what goes into the supplemental budget. So that gives us possibly three options, and we can't get into capital projects. So, you know, we'll have to look at that. But I guess my concern is that we have to begin, you know, being realistic about what this is going to take, how long it's going to take, where we're going to get the funding for, how we're going to get the funding. Because we're not going to, one last thing is that we're not going to build enough roads to solve our transportation problem. The transportation volume, 4% a year, that's 20% more cars on the road in 5 years. Better build your transportation, your own transit projects. You're not sure that I have. Well, none of us will be able to meet. So let me end with that, but I hope that at least clarifies where we need to go and how long we're going to take to get there.
Yeah, go ahead.
I'll just jump in from the transit perspective, just kind of address a couple things. On the FTA side, as it flows through the Maryland Transit Administration, we look to a variety of documents, just as we look to the priority letters for Howard County to set their priorities. I'd also say that on the locally operated transit system side, there's a 5-year transportation development plan that each locally operated transit system is required to do. John's familiar with this, the 5-year TDP. That TDP sort of looks at growth changes, where routes might be restructured, and where that would go. And so to kind of, you know, get right down to the nitty-gritty of the bridge project, we probably need to see how this bridge is reflected in that document. So I guess what I'm getting at is, prior to funding, we need to see the right kind of planning that leads to that funding. And so the TDP, I would think, would need to show how routes would be restructured on the transit side. Adding the bridge connection feels to me like a pretty significant change to your current route structure. Does that work with your current maintenance facility? How does it connect with your maintenance facility? Is it a different transit vehicle? Do you need all new kinds of spare parts? Can your maintenance facility accommodate those kinds of vehicles? There's a lot of questions that need to be answered. As the responsible steward of federal dollars, as a first step to that. And then after the TDP, each locally operated system submits an annual transportation plan, an ATP. And so that's sort of the annual request for operating and capital dollars. And so with each of those requests, we match that up with the 5-year transportation development plan. So we want to be sure that your 5-year plan reflects this type of a transit operation, and that your then annual request reflects the correct operating and capital funding to support that. So that's sort of the prerequisite for all of this from the transit side.
In terms of the funding, following up on what Delegate Turner is saying.
You pull the mic over.
In relation to the funding issue and following up on what Delegate Turner's excellent suggestions, I might even add the Howard County delegation submit X amount of money for the planning or something like that, or design. What I'm getting at is, could we do a package where we get a little money from this, a little money from the other thing, a little money from something else, so we're not just looking at one source, but bringing together as a package and then achieve the goal of X amount of dollars. But would you be helping us on that, working closely with the county? In case we can't get all the money, whatever it amounts to, from one source, why not just pick at everybody, try and get a package deal?
Yeah, definitely. We'd like to participate. And I think the county's already invested some money in the initial study. So it's like anything else. 6 years goes very fast, and you know we update the plan every year, so it's a 6-year program. But somehow it's got to get into the process, and so you got to start somewhere. So this is the beginning of a conversation. The other thing that I wanted to mention, this is why being a local initiative becomes so important, is if you look at, you know, what's being proposed here from downtown Columbia to Oakland Mills, it's really a local project. starts in a local area and moves to a local area. Whereas, you know, 29 is the network that leads into interchanges, it goes into 70. So we really have to rely on local initiative to drive this because it is a local project.
Just one follow up. I just had one of our great citizens do a research for it here. 792 Tiger grant, Tiger applications, 72 were funded.
72, 10%.
72.
10%. That's what I'm getting. Other questions? Yes, sir.
I have a comment and then a question. You started off talking about how you have about $15 billion to spend over the next 6 years and the wish list is $75 billion. And I'm sure a lot of people heard that, wow, that's oversubscribed by a great amount. But what I heard was that you have $15 billion to spend in the next 6 years. And I think we need to have the kind of conversation we just had about setting the priorities for that $15 billion. And if it has to move to the seventh year because that's the one that's not spoken for yet, fine, but it's a priority setting process and you're looking for guidance from the county, you know, and local government for that. So I think that's all been helpful. I was very pleased to see that your list of priority criteria included things like economic development, which Kay has already asked about, bicycle and pedestrian development, and transit-oriented development, which this could easily be categorized as, particularly considering how important it's going to be to Oakland Mills and Long Reach and some of the other areas in downtown. Can you talk a little bit about how you measure transit-oriented?
Yeah, that's a great question. Transit-oriented development in the Maryland context, can't speak nationally, but the way it's evolved here over the last several years has been focused primarily on rail. So you've got the MARC stations, you've got the WMATA stations. So that it's really been a rail focus. If there was a very large bus center, I don't imagine you'll have a central or regional bus center here in Howard County, but if you had one, that might be a TOD opportunity, but heretofore, and so what we do is we inventory all of the TOD opportunities along the rail lines. So for example, Savage has just built a garage. If you've noticed the garage that went up there, that was the developer put that up. That was part of a TOD designation for Savage along the Camden line. Odenton, if one of the other impacts on Howard County, of course, is the RAC that's going and all the growth that's going on at Fort Meade. So we're looking carefully at the intermodal issues up at Fort Meade because you've got the Overton stop there. That's designated as a transit-oriented development. And then you may have seen in the paper the last week or so, we're starting to have conversations down in Laurel Park. There's a developer who is proposing, and it's fairly far along, about 1,000 units, 125,000 retail, 650,000 square feet of office, which is just going to pour traffic onto one south into Prince George's County. And we're trying to figure out on a regional basis how that's going to work. So the reason I mention that is because there's a TOD there at Laurel City, and we're having a conversation with Laurel City about how do we coordinate with Howard County, because if you suddenly build 5,000, so and I think there's a TIF proposal in play for garages. So if Howard County decides to support a TIF, which builds 5,000 parking spaces at Laurel Park, it's going to change the dynamic of that stop. And so, you know, of course, we've had that initial conversation with both Howard County and Anne County and Laurel City. Laurel City is not as enthusiastic about the conversation as we hope, but we're going to continue that and drive that process. So the TOD is really focused on rail, is the short answer to the question.
Well, I'd like to suggest that one of the things we've heard, or the Oakland Mills Village Board has heard, is that transit's important at a smaller scale to develop the prospects of Oakland Mills, and that you might want to rethink the scale at which you, you know, say the threshold for transit-oriented development starts. Because I think there's more to it, even at a smaller scale. Particularly if we have an opportunity like we have to provide an exclusive right-of-way for buses.
Okay, great. We'd love to talk to you more about that.
One more question, if anybody has another question before we move on.
So we're getting the hook here.
This is more an observation rather than a question. I've been involved in the federal transit program for about 50 years. I worked both for the Broward Transit Administration and also in Boston for the BTA. There are a number of sources of federal funds that could be used for this project. Reference has been made to the Tiger program. The Tiger program is relatively small. It was $600 million this fiscal year, and as a matter of fact, the House of Representatives cut down to $100 million. The next year's appropriation bill, which probably will go up a bit, when the Senate acts. But I think a better source of funding would be the formula program. The formula program is funded from the trust fund. It runs about $60 million a year for the global metropolitan area. You're not competing against anybody else in the country. Of course, you're competing within yourselves, with Maryland. But I think that would be a better source of federal funds to look at as a possibility of funding this project, and not just relying on the program.
Kevin,
you
want to speak to
I think I agree. There are formula funds that are available right now. Howard County primarily gets operating funds on that side of the county. I think if we were going to allocate dollars towards capital funds, again, we would want to see the request come through our annual transportation plan process. Just as every jurisdiction makes that request to their local average transit system through the county every year, we would look to see this in there, at which point we'd evaluate the capital request also in light of the operating dollars associated with that request.
And as Jenny mentioned, part of the package, I think, what's the transit? It's about $11 million.
Yeah.
Comes to Howard County now.
How much?
So $11 million, rough and ready. And then I think we've got the statewide for both regions, it's about $93 million coming into the state. So, you know, that could be a piece of the package possible.
Okay, thank you very much. Okay, we're going to move on now to John Powell, who's with the Office of Transportation, is going to do a presentation. We had a couple other people come into the room, Senator DeZone, Delegate Eversall, Councilmember Tarasa. I think I got everybody. So, John, take it away.
Thank you. Good morning, everybody.
Good morning.
Okay. We have the opportunity, exciting opportunity, to do a project called Bridge Columbia. It's a feasibility project. And this project was included a number of participants, but I do want to give special thanks to Romain Kessiker, who is sitting over here from the back, raise your hand. He works for URS, and he was the project manager for the feasibility study. So a lot of what we'll go through is obviously the work that's been done by Romain and his friends at URS. The presentation will go through a study area. You already know what the study area is, but we'll go through it real quick. The study approach, and this is going to be particularly important to understand how we approach this. The existing conditions of the bridge, so we understand exactly where we are today with the bridge, what our findings were, and then a couple of conclusions that we'll put at the very end of this. The study area you're aware of, it's in downtown Columbia, connecting Oakland Mills to the downtown center. This is a picture from Howard Hughes of the new pathway that will go through. You can see exactly how it's all connected. And the way you get from one side to the other is across the bridge. The bridge is 10 feet across, which is, by the way, acceptable for bicycle and pedestrians. It feels a little closer than that. Anybody that's been across that bridge knows that. It feels a little more restricted. But actually, that works. Here's a picture of the bridge. And for those that have never been on it, it's not the most appealing thing in the world. Obviously, it needs a little touch-up. And you'll also notice in this picture, in this picture, you'll also notice that when you get off the bridge, you're essentially right next to a forest. So it not only does the bridge itself feel a little tight, but when you get on and off the bridge, you're feeling just as tight because of the way the forest is really running up toward the pathway. So the study approach, first, complete a feasibility study. We're going to talk about that in a moment. Determine the status of the existing bridge. One of the real main ideas behind this project, and incidentally, just as an FYI, it took a year for us to get agreement on what the scope of services was going to be. Because everybody had a different idea of how they wanted to spend the money that the county council was smart enough to put aside to do a project. And it took a year just to get agreement on what we should be doing. But the very heart of that was, what can you do with the existing bridge? Because at the end of the day, if you can't do anything with the existing bridge, then there isn't any sense looking at that option, and we need to start thinking about our options. So the first step was, let's see what we can do with the existing bridge. Then develop options, excuse me, for improving the pedestrian and bicycle element of the bridge. So, look at the existing bridge, then what can we do with it as it evolves the bike and pedestrian? Then, what are the options for adding transit? Because we're certainly aware of the fact that Oakland Mills is, and others are very interested in adding transit. Then evaluate and develop the options for the pathways. The bridge is one part of this. The second part of it is these pathways. How do we open up these pathways and get these pathways to the point that people are comfortable to access the bridge? And then finally, to provide a number of observations that would be necessary. We had a lot of partners in this. Again, it took a year to get the scope of services put together. But when we did the project, we actually had a project team or a project oversight committee, whatever we wanted to call it. And it had all these organizations involved in the process. So when Romaine and URS and the Office of Transportation were moving forward with this project, we did it with a number of people that are in this room. So it was not done in a silo. Now, we talked about the feasibility study, and Sir Fred mentioned in his presentation that there's not real agreement as to whether or not the numbers we came up with are the same numbers that they've come up with. It's very important to understand, and you don't really need to read this, other than to understand that the feasibility is on the left side and construction and final design is on the right side, and there's a number of steps that are involved in between. The 30% design is the next issue. That's the next thing we want to do. We want to get to 30% design, which will give you much better numbers and a much better time estimate. That costs a lot of money. And if we don't know what we're doing, we've got all these options out there, and there's not exactly agreement on which one we should do, then all of a sudden we can't spend that kind of money to be doing a 30% design. So the feasibility design, feasibility study, is a 30,000 foot look at just what you can do. So if the numbers are off a little bit, they're off a little bit. And if the time guidelines are off a little bit, they're off a little bit. But what the key is, it's the relativity. If you look at one option, you look at the next option, whether there's a change or not, you're still going to have that kind of a difference with that second option. So that's what's important about this study approach. This is a feasibility study, 30,000 foot, what can we do? The existing conditions, believe it or not, it's a pretty solid bridge. It will take a vehicle. It'll take a vehicle of 20,000 pounds, and you can actually put people in the vehicle. As Romaine explained to me today, when it says pedestrian loading governs, it's actually an H10 vehicle or 85 pounds per square foot, and the 85 pounds per square foot weighs more than the 20,000 pound vehicle. So that bridge is pretty solid, and it can take a vehicle. It is 10 feet wide in size, we know it's acceptable for biking bed. And you can put a transit on there up to 20,000 pounds. The deck is in very good condition. The coating on the parapet is peeling. We all know that needs to be worked on. The girder, however, is in very good condition. The substructure is in very good condition. The bridge is in pretty good shape. So we start off understanding that this bridge is in very good shape and it can be used. Now, we come to some conclusions. The existing bridge is in good condition and can support many more years of activity, but it can't do bike, ped, and transit at the same time. So while it can do one of them, transit, if it doesn't, then you can't get bike and ped because there's not enough room on the bridge. And even at 10 feet, if you're running transit over there, I would not want to run BRT buses on a 10-foot highway across that bridge. That would be pretty tight, but you could do it. And then, in order to achieve transit, we're going to have to do something. We're going to have to renovate, retrofit, or we're going to have to replace it, one or the other. So let's look at the first option, retrofit the existing bridge. And with this particular option, it's the lowest cost, and it's the shortest completion time, and it's what we've been talking about really for the last 6 months. It has minimal environmental impact, and it integrates with the Howard Hughes passage. So the first thing we look at is, well, let's see what we can do today. We know that Howard Hughes has $500,000 that they have committed to upgrading the bridge. And what we have to do is determine what we can do beyond that. And at the very least, we've got the $500,000 from Howard Hughes. Now this is the way, you know, these are some pictures of some bridges that we could use. That'd be pretty spectacular. That's sort of neat. There's a lot of people like that one. That's pretty good bridge. So what that does is that tells you that you can do something else besides what we have and make it look good. And have a nice bridge that's going over 29 and even to the point of finding what downtown Columbia is. And Columbia itself. The second option now is to actually have a complementary bridge that's built right alongside the existing bridge. It is the lowest cost and the shortest in completion of time beyond the first option, obviously. It doesn't have a lot of impact. The one thing it does is as soon as you start running transit across that bridge, you're going to have to figure out what you're going to do on both sides of the bridge. Because you not only have a roadway that you're going to have to build, you're going to have passing lanes for the buses. And all of a sudden, you're going to start eating up some ground. There's some area that's going to be taken up by doing this. And all the options that we talk about, whether it be the single transit or the double transit, all of those options have that same challenge. What do you do on both sides of the bridge? How are you going to handle that pull-off? Because those pull-offs are going to be required. The next option is to do a cable stay bridge, and it requires the demolishing of the existing bridge. Now, any of the options that require demolishing the existing bridge means that for a period of a half a year and a half, 2 years, you're not going to be able to get from Oakland Mills to downtown Columbia across that bridge. So any of these options where we're demolishing anything, we're going to be cutting off the connectivity. It will provide a major landmark, the same issues with the transit trail and approaches and the pull-offs. Now the next picture is a picture of a cable stay for those that don't speak bridge. It is a bridge in which the weight of the deck is supported by a number of cables running directly to one or more towers. The second option, or the next option, we have option 3B, is to do a cable stay bridge with dual transit. And it's exactly the same other than you have the two lanes coming across the bridge itself. But now you're starting to run into another problem, because you have, if you have the two lanes, then what are you going to do on both sides of the bridge? Where the walkways are, you're going to have two lanes of transit. Or are you still back to the passing lanes? Option four is an iconic bridge with a single transit. And it would be an iconic landmark. The tower height doesn't need to be as high. Same issues with the trails, same issues with the bogs. Doesn't change. And an iconic bridge, again, for the same non-bridge speaking people, is a bridge in which the design is unique to that bridge only. So it would be something that would really be representative of Columbia and Howard County. Option 4B is the same thing, only this time with transit. I couldn't find a real good picture, and I would like somebody to explain to me how the bike gets around.
really
I'm going to say they're going to have to move really quick to get around. But it is a great picture. That came up as a bridge, so I don't know how it works. But it would be the same thing. You've got the dual transit. You'd have the issues with the pathways and the issue with the passing. And of course, as we're doing this, the cost keeps rising. And we all are aware of that. Now, one of our fine council members, I won't mention this person's name, said we need to look at an option across the bridge, across the lake. So we did an option across the lake, and when we looked at it, we said, well, if we're going to go across the lake, we might as well do dual transit anyway. There's no sense doing single transit. So we put that together. It has significant environmental impact. You're running into wetlands, you're running into all kinds of issues as you try to get this accomplished. Obviously, it's going to cost an awful lot. It's going to impact the neighborhood because it's going to land where it doesn't land today. So it is going to change that on both sides. There are some issues, by the way, trying to get to Little Patuxent Parkway. And you may get a few people that don't want to see a bridge going across the lake. Just might get a couple comments here and there. So we see that as an option, but we don't see that as a likely option. But it is possible. Next one, please. Option 5B is interesting in that you would have a lake bridge for the transit only. And then you would keep the existing bridge, which of course would be renovated, and then that bridge would be for pedestrian and bicyclists only. Again, some of the same issues that you would have with the first option of the dual transit. The sixth option we looked at was personal rapid transit. We think this would be sort of interesting if you had these little cars and they were coming across. That's the one. And then finally, the path options. And, you know, we had a lot of conversations with people from the county council on, you know, what do we do with the path? But the paths end up where the paths end up. And, you know, you can only do so much. So what we ended up doing is looking at the one option we thought we had, which was really to do a boardwalk. And the problem with the boardwalk is the access by the neighbors, is they would have to go to the end of the boardwalk in order to get on. So we're not sure that works, but it certainly is an option. And finally, this is what it would look like if you have the transit and you have the boardwalk. All right, so what does all this cost? It may be hard to see back there, but we end up with a beginning cost of around $2 billion for retrofitting the existing bridge, all the way up to $161 million if we have the lake bridge with the dual transit. And there are a lot of numbers in between in the 30s and the 40s. So it is not inexpensive. It is a challenge to do this, but these are the options we came up with that we think ought to be on the table for discussion. Finally, some other considerations. We could be involved in wetlands and floodplain. The transit options are going to require modifications to the pathways that could impact the neighborhood. Forest mitigation may be required. There are some 17 laws and regulations we may have to work around in order to get stuff done. And there are 18 environmental services that may be required. Additionally, there's no right-of-way acquisition costs that we're assuming when we put these numbers together. The single lane transit is going to need to be timed to make sure that you're not meeting on the bridge. That's not going to work. The system is going to be needed to keep pedestrians off the transit bridge. Travel on 29 would likely be impacted with any other option other than number one. And the options with the existing bridge, as we said before, would be demolished. It means there's no connectivity for a period of time. And finally, the maintenance costs are going to be higher with any of these other bridges, whether it's Cable State or Atomic. So, conclusions, implement option one as soon as possible. We think that's the low-hanging fruit. We think that's something that can move us forward because it's going to take time to get to the next option, to get to the next conclusion. It took a year for us to agree on the scope of services. How long is it going to take us to agree on which of these other options, if any, we should choose? So we believe we should do that. We're already looking for funding sources to support option one. So beyond the $500,000 for Howard Hughes, we're actually looking for something through the Maryland Bike Program that might help us improve the bridge as well. Identify the preference and preferences for the 30% design. As soon as somebody decides what direction, you know, we should head in, then we can start looking at getting the funding for some of the planning and that activity. And finally, and I can't stress this enough, you can make this bridge beautiful and you can make it open and give it an iconic design, you can do all these wonderful things, but if you don't open up the pathways, it is still going to be uncomfortable for many people to walk through that area. You've got to open it up. And the recommendation from our consultant, and I agree with it, by the way, so I'm not putting it on his back, is that it has to be 50 feet on each side. And that's a lot of area that right now has trees and brush and other stuff on it. But that's what it's going to take if you're going to get people to use this bridge and use it comfortably. I'm done. Someday we'll have something that looks like this. Thank you.
Thank you, John. Very, very helpful information. I also wanted to recognize Heather Campbell is here from Senator Cardin's office, as well as Laurie Elbert from Senator McCulkey's office. So we're happy to have them here. We have now our final presenters to talk about planning that has been done for the third interchange along Route 29. So we have Holger Serrano from DPW, as well as Marshall McLaughlin from TPC. Thank you.
I'm going to talk first real briefly about the CEPAs, the community enhancements, programs and projects that are required as part of the downtown plan, just to provide an overview. And then Holger's going to talk in more detail about one of those, which is the third interchange. I didn't realize we were going to have such a big crowd, so I brought only 25 handouts. So I started them in the middle with the folks from MDOT, and I'm sorry if they don't go all the way around. I think that the local people are mostly aware of these because these come directly out of the downtown Columbia plan. And what I included was basically just a couple of maps that are in the downtown plan. The purpose of redeveloping downtown is to take a lot of surface parking lot and turn it into more interesting things to make downtown more vital in a broad variety of ways that are outlined in the plan. The first drawing is basically a street framework where you'll see new roads going through what are currently parking lots to provide a better functioning road network. But also you'll notice that there is an extension of the southern leg of the combined of the loop road that goes around the mall. It goes across the tip of the lake. And that would be the third interchange. It is recognized in the downtown plan, there were traffic studies that were done, that over time, while we want more and more people to use transit and bike and pedestrian options as opposed to cars, we still have a lot of cars coming and going through downtown to get to 29, whether they're coming directly from downtown or from the villages on the western and southern sides of downtown. And the capacity of the interchanges at 175 and Brokenland function pretty well now, but as we project out into the future, there isn't going to be enough capacity. So the expectation is, as we get towards the latter years of the
the build-out of the downtown plan, that third interchange is likely to be needed. As I said, hopefully we'll talk more about that. The second one is the pedestrian and bicycle network, and it shows going across 29, the existing bridge, just a little arrow, but it's intended to be the connection that goes across to link eastern and western Columbia. The next couple pages in this handout are from the downtown plan, and they are the sequence. And I underpicked the pages that include the two things we're here to talk about today. The first one is number three, which is that Howard Hughes, now as the lead petitioner and developer of downtown, has to, at its expense, conduct a study of the third interchange, which is what Pedro Serrano is going to talk about. And the 12th one is really about the bike and pedestrian plan. And there's a little drawing in there, an aerial, that shows how it will connect essentially all the way from the hospital and the community college through downtown on Little Patuxent Parkway, over 29 to Oakland Mills and to Glendale Park. What the 12th SEPA says, and the purpose of this chart is basically to say what things have to be accomplished early in the redevelopment of downtown versus later or towards the end. And the 12th SEPA is about this combined pedestrian and bicycle path. And if you look at the little heading there, it says that before there's issuance of a building permit for the 500,000 square foot of development in downtown, whether that's hotel, office, residential, retail, 500,000 square feet is early in the process. There are projections of the downtown build-out as being roughly 5,500 units of housing, about 5,000 units of office, and about another 1,000 square feet of retail. So a very robust development plan, and 500,000 square feet is in the very beginning of that plan. And this combined path is supposed to be done before we issue the building permit. We are just about to that point. There is some language in the very beginning of the chart that allows that if there are extenuating circumstances and a good alternative, the planning board may allow some variation in the SEPAs, and they have granted a slight time extension for completion of the path. It has taken us a lot longer than anyone ever envisioned to get the design worked out for the path. It crosses many different properties and has required easements from many different property owners. The engineering, of course, it's been complicated because we wanted to accomplish all kinds of security goals, aesthetic goals, environmental goals. But the plans are all done. The construction is getting started now on the second piece, the first piece, which runs from Little Patuxent Parkway pretty much to the edge of the bridge that crosses over 29, is in place right now, running across Symphony Woods and coming by the library. However, the construction will be starting down towards the hospital and can be starting at Blandair, and we'll be working towards the bridge. And the dispensation that the planning board gave was that this 500,000 square foot building permit for that 500,000 square foot, which will be the next phase of the Metropolitan. Many of you attended the grand opening of the Metropolitan last week. The next phase of the Metropolitan will be two buildings on either side of the extension of Twin Rivers into the mall from Wild Lake, and they're ready to go with those plans, and they will be looking for that building permit soon. So they've been given dispensation that they can't get the completion use occupancy permit so that anyone can actually move into those two buildings until the plan is done. So that all comes down to the fact that now Howard Hughes will be building as fast as it possibly can from both Glendair and from the hospital to complete the pieces. And certainly the piece that is connecting across 29 is an important component of it. So my hope is that we will hopefully expedite the conversation that has been going on for quite some time about whether we go ahead and we improve and make it feel more safe and more attractive the bridge that exists now short term, in order to make these pieces that want to jump across 29 work really well while we're working out a longer term solution. Because as I said, we have a deadline for being able to have occupancy in those next two buildings down in the downtown area. Maybe so. Hoover would like to talk now about the, your chair.
Thank you, Marcia. Good morning.
Morning.
What I'm going to do today is I'll give you a little presentation on the purpose and name of the interchange. Talk about four concepts. The study itself had 10 concepts. Mayor had four, just four. I think it'll give you a feel of what to be looked at. And some cost aspects, some cost. And, of course, challenges, other challenges with the project. So if you look at the display, what you'll see up there is US 29 going north towards Ellicott City in this direction. And going this way, it's going down. There you go. Thank you. Right here, we have Brooklyn Parkway and Little Patuxent Parkway, Maryland 75 interchange. This map is showing you the no build, which means we don't do anything in the year 2035. And some of the things that we look at is the level of traffic flow. We grade intersections and different things by letters. So if something's graded an A, an intersection, that means the traffic's really good, everything's flowing. If something's level an F, that means it's failing. And so basically what happens in 2035, this area here will fail, some of these areas here will fail, and then sporadically intersections throughout the 175 corridor will also fail. Now, the distance between these two interchanges is about 2 miles, 1.7 miles. So one of the things that we're looking at in the Streets Village study is to put the third interchange somewhere in the vicinity of this area. Okay. So what I'm going to do is talk about the first alternative, I will call it concept A, and this is a half diamond interchange. So what I want to do is kind of walk you through this one in a little more detail. And if you look at this area up here, this is where the mall is, and the Little Patuxent Parkway comes up here. So at this location, we would have a traffic signal, and we would start a roadway coming down the hill, because this from here to here, there's a 50-foot drop. So we would gradually come down the hill, and then this orange color signifies a bridge. So that would be all in structure. And 29 southbound is right here. Whenever you build a bridge, you have to be at least 60'9" over the roadway. That's a standard that we use. And we would go to the median of 29. Now, in the median of 29, this only provides partial access because people coming from northbound could access and go into this downtown area. And if you want to leave, you would come over the bridge and then again head northbound. The south entrance will be enhanced. That would still remain open. And so this is one of the options that we have. Now, we would also continue to maintain the existing pedestrian bridge. That would remain. The bridge itself will not have any sidewalks or bikeways because it's really pedestrian. Transit would use it normally less than any other transit facility, just a street. And the second alternative is what we call concept C, a full diamond interchange. Now, this concept is very similar to the first one in the sense that we start at the corner here with the parkway and we go across to the median. But the big difference here is that there is movement in all north and southbound directions. So before you could only get up to the bridge from northbound, now you can also do the same from southbound. And you would also exit southbound. And in this case, we would close the south entrance because there's really no need for it. Now, some of the alternatives that I'm talking about that I'm not showing, what happens instead of going to the median, we actually extend the intersection to the outside, to this location, and move the roadway to the center. So that's a big difference. The next concept is what we call a flyover, and this again we start at the same location. We do have a longer bridge in this case because it kind of curves over towards the median, The width of this is less than the other ones. This is only one lane each direction. And it would connect over to the, as you're exiting, to the northbound lanes, and you would pick it up from the southbound lanes going in. Again, the existing pedestrian bridge would stay in place. And on the three examples that I showed, there's no sidewalks or any paths on the bridge itself. Connection F, now this is an interesting one because it actually connects to Oakland Mills. Now let me walk you through this one a little bit. We started at the same location, but what we're doing this one was we wanted to use the existing location of the current pedestrian bridge. So we introduced an S-curve, and this path actually follows where the existing bridge is. And it would kind of wiggle through the apartment buildings there and go down to Stevens Ford Road down here. Now this is seen more as a boulevard. So since it is seen as a boulevard, we would have a hiker-biker trail on the south side of the structure. And it would have the created in a boulevard atmosphere, so it'd be at the lower speed, and it'd be made so it's friendly for people to walk and bike. So the pedestrian bridge is definitely gone at this location. Okay, so I kind of showed you four different concepts. When we do these cost estimates during planning stage, we don't have right-of-way knowledge yet. So this does not include right-of-way. It does have contingencies, and it's using current dollars, and actually it's projected a few more years for inflation. But once that few, it's only like 3 more years. But they range from $44 million to $82 million. So it's just a pretty expensive structure. But part of this is when you're building over at 29 and it's an existing facility that's moving a lot of traffic, maintenance of traffic is an important component, and that also drives the cost of those projects. Now, the challenge is I listed Federal Highway SHJ, and the reason is this US 29 is kind of like a federal highway. SHJ controls it. So we would have to work closely with both agencies, and as John indicated earlier, the environmental agencies, if we get involved, are over 18 agencies. You have the Corps of Engineers involved, MVE, and a lot of this is because of the wetlands. By the lake and on that side, I mean, you have a river flowing through, and that whole area is very sensitive. So it's one of those things where my past, I've worked with a lot of federal agencies. Whenever water's involved, it's a very complicated issue. And it's something that years ago when I first got engineering, it was great because we went out there and did things. It was great from my perspective. But over the years, what happened is you learned that you were not being kind to the environment. And now, with the environment in there, you really are. So you get the best thing. You get a nice green facility, but it takes a lot longer. But it's a worthwhile process. And that ends my presentation. If you have any questions, I'm happy to answer. Yes?
Is this one on? Okay, before we got up. The option that did connect Oakland Mills, did that send traffic to 29, both northbound, southbound, on and off?
There is one like that. The one that I showed did not, but there is an option like that that does do that.
Okay, so the option you showed, there was no connectivity to 29. The boulevard simply went over 29, but traffic couldn't get down to 29 or up from 29. Is that correct?
No. Okay. The option that I showed had traffic northbound to 29 could get on that boulevard, and then to leave, you could leave northbound. I didn't have a full connection to 29. I didn't show the southbound connection. That was specific.
Okay, and then some comment, many people in Oakland Mills, a concern if there is a connection, the third interchange, is that people in downtown would use that as a cut through our village
to get to other arteries. For example, somebody's living near the mall, and they normally come across that drop down to 29, go north and pick up 175. If they see the traffic's backed up on 29, they're not going to drop down on 29. They're going to come across Oakland Mills, come up Thunder Hill Road to get on 175. And that's a major concern that people at Oakland Mills have. And we want to see significant traffic studies on that issue of cut-through traffic to Oakland Mills.
I agree. I mean, that's really important. And right now, that would be my concerns.
Yeah. Thank you.
What I'd like to do is save the questions for after our break. We've been sitting quite a while. I'd like to take about a 10-minute break, and then we'll have an informal discussion with questions and answers. Marshall will be here, Hobo will be here, and we'd like to do that. Before we break, though, I'd like to recognize Michelle McGovern is here from Congressman Sarbanes' office, so thank you for attending. So let's, 10-minute break, 11:15. Oh yeah, I mentioned you earlier, Delegate.
Thank you.
Yes, yes. All right, thank you everybody. 10 minutes. 11:15, we'll reconvene. All right, everyone. We're gonna wrap this up with an informal discussion. I have on your agenda just a couple of talking points. I think that the information that we have gotten has been very helpful. Obviously, we all in the room know that this is a complicated project. More so, I find out after this morning's dialogue. But we do have some, I'm certain there are some questions that we still have. I see we've lost the MDOT folks, so that's not good. It's unfortunate.
Up.
Hold on, I'm sorry.
The question was, I'm certain it, that Councilmember Drush had, was what is driving up the cost, particularly on the option, the last third one from the bottom, the 5A?
Okay. First, let me retract what I said earlier. It does include widening the pathways. That's the call I was making. I apologize for that. So that is included. The biggest driver for the cost of the lake options is building over a lake. It's all those expenses that are going to be involved, not only in the engineering, but in the actual construction itself. There may need to be a number of pillars that are in the lake itself. You know, it depends on the design of the bridge and how we do that. But that is a very, very expensive option. And then we're still going to have the issues when we get on both sides of that bridge. The grade between where the bridge is going to be and Little Patuxent Parkway is not simple for that direct connection. So it's something that is just very expensive, just simply because you're building over water.
I guess part of my question is in relation to the costs that were associated with the third interchange, which, if I recall, the highest cost was $82 million. I don't know if you could bring that one up. But my understanding is that's going over the same area with the same environmental impact, with the same issues of widening the path on either side. So these numbers don't make any sense to me if they are in the same area. From my perspective, it defies any logical thought on this. I'm not a transportation expert, but to think that you could do a third interchange for these costs, but that a bridge over that same area would be so significantly more expensive. I mean, one of the options was double that $82 million. So I'm wondering if these costs are missing some of that stuff, or what the issue is.
Part of it is the location of the bridge. The bridge under the third interchange is much shorter than the bridge that would be going over, that we designed for the British Columbia.
But doesn't the third interchange have to then reach a road on either side? I mean, it seems to me that has to get from the same place to the same place.
Well, but it's doing it with a shorter distance over the water. Now, having said that, remember that we said that the costs that we estimated, they may have been a little lower than what Wayne was telling me. They're a little better than the 30,000 foot that I said, but they're still estimates based on feasibility study. And they did try to do a lot of detail, a lot more detail than they normally would do in a feasibility study. I do not have an answer, and maybe you do, as to why there's a difference. But I can tell you that there's a big difference in the amount of space that we're covering over that bridge. We're almost double the amount of area that we're covering.
One thing, too, that the administration had regarding the URS study was that we were concerned that a 40% contingency was quite significant. And there was a 15% inflation and a 40% contingency. Those numbers seem very high to us, too, so we had asked that question.
So in the bridge, it was a 15% inflation, 40% contingency. Do we know what was used for the third interchange?
Yes, what it is the same factors. That's a standard state highway factors that are used in the plan study. I would have to analyze the two to see the difference in the cost, and I would do that. Because it does raise the question as to why it costs that much more. So I will get back to you on that.
Okay, thank you. I also wanted to recognize Paul Farragut. I failed earlier to recognize Paul. He is a former council member. He also was the project manager on the original bridge. It's still standing and in good condition. So thank you, Paul, for being here.
So do we know, or when you look at that, can you look at whether the interchange includes getting to the associated roads that you would need to get to?
It does.
It does?
Yes. That's why I was looking at this.
Right, that's why it doesn't make that.
I agree.
Also, in terms of the widening, is there, and we're talking about the pathways that Howard Hughes is building? And if that's the case, why aren't those required to be widened to begin with by Howard Hughes?
I'm I can't hear you.
So one of the costs, and I'm interested if we can get a breakdown of what part of that cost is the widening of the pathways. But if that's the case, I'm wondering why that wasn't, if those are the pathways that Howard Hughes is putting in as part of the SEPA, I'm wondering why they're not being put in to begin with, widened at the expense of Howard Hughes.
Marcia, can you speak to that?
This wasn't, well, actually, it seems to be going on. Because this was an unresolved issue, we basically have gone with a standard path based on the design consultant's recommendation for the combined path. It will be 10 feet wide all along the entire route. Certainly the area that would be, if we end up with a widening in the location of the existing bridge to accommodate transit, it's going to have to get rebuilt.
And what about the clearing? The 50-foot clearing that in John's presentation, I think he said that was one of the most important. I know it's a conversation.
I think Howard Hughes is prepared to do all the clearing that's necessary.
The 50,
if that's what we decide is necessary, I think everybody wants this to be as comfortable and safe as possible.
Fred, did you have something?
This is a question that has to do with the third interchange. How much of that cost is the obligation of Howard Hughes as part of their SEPA?
The traffic studies
that have to be done by Howard Hughes will be tracking if we go along what improvements are necessary. If at some point the downtown traffic projections indicate that we really need to have that interchange, that would be something that has to be negotiated between the county, because the amount of traffic coming from downtown is some significant portion, but if you have traffic coming from Wild Lake and Harper's Choice and Hickory Ridge as well coming from downtown, that would impact and what the fair share is for Howard Hughes versus the county. It makes me concerned.
Is there
an additional
development? Is there planned additional development in that area other than the, what Kittleman's putting in Wild Lake?
The lakefront area as well as the mall all, you know, likely to be impacting the two existing interchanges. If there was a third interchange coming out along going right across the lake, the third interchange is the shortest option.
Right, but I thought you said you were trying to decide for in terms of who paid for the third interchange. You said some of it might be traffic, additional traffic coming from Wild Lake.
I don't know if it's additional traffic, but the percentage of traffic that comes from immediately in the downtown core as opposed to the percentage of traffic that comes around the downtown in order to get from Wild Lake, Harper's Choice, or Hickory Ridge would be something that would be evaluated.
So, Marcia, correct me if I'm wrong. All of the development downtown as well as all of the development in Howard County pays a roads excise tax, if I'm not mistaken.
New construction does not exist.
Well, right, new construction. And so we're looking at new construction. And that is, at least currently, the use for that is road capacity, correct?
Yes.
So if we are collecting a significant amount of excise tax through the new development downtown, it seems reasonable to think that that excise tax would then be available, that the money that's generated there would be available to assist in a third interchange, because that's actually capacity building. Yes?
It certainly could assist. Whether that covers the entire thing, and right now I don't believe there has been anything that has earmarked that money. Excise tax is allowed to be spent anywhere within Howard County, so if it's generated on Route 1 or if it's generated on Route 40, it could be spent anywhere.
Correct, but, and it has been. I mean, development that's happened in other parts of the county have supported our road network across the county, just like development that's happened in Columbia has supported road development in other parts of the county. So I recognize that, but because it's viewed, I think, as a general upgrade of roads for the general public as opposed to just one specific area, right, it can be used.
Is there a timeline to start a process to eliminate some of the options? Because I struggle to understand how we can move forward with so many options.
Part of what we're here about is to see what kind of funding possibilities there are. It helps kind of frame the discussion on how much we can spend, will spend, need to spend. I know that the Bridge Columbia folks had, their preference, as I recall, was an option 3B or 4A.
3B, we were focusing on 3B, really, that's a good option, but 4B is very similar, so it's hard for us to tell what was the real difference between the two.
So I hear you, I feel exactly the same way. How can we move forward to the next step? I wasn't expecting here, I appreciate Delegate Turner's remarks earlier about the timing and going forward in the sixth year, seventh year, really helped for me kind of put the timeline together in terms of where do we go from here.
So. I'd like to make another comment on this table that's up on the board. I said earlier in my presentation we had some doubts about the cost in the feasibility study. And by the way, I think John and his staff did an excellent job on this study for the most part. We got some comments on this, but overall I think it's a very useful exercise. The concern is really in that third column over, the one that says 15% inflation and 40% contingency. And in the last column over in the time estimates, if you multiply out something for 9 years, the numbers start to get very large. And that's what's happened here. And if you've got numbers that are 40% to start with, I was very interested in the Deputy Secretary's comment that they are now going to smaller contingency percentages in their in-house cost estimates. Because I think you can kind of kid yourself, brush yourself right out of the ballpark by throwing these huge contingency numbers at these projects, and I think that's what's happened here. So I think one of the things we like to see as this project goes forward is a more careful look at how the pricing is done.
Yes, Bill?
Yes, question and comment. Is the existing footbridge good enough to get Howard Hughes' building permit? And if so, then let's pick one of the bridge options and spend the $500,000 doing the engineering design on it. So is the existing footbridge, is that sufficient for Howard Hughes to get his next building permit?
Marcia? Well, I guess that's a good question for discussion purposes. I think because people have expressed so much concern about the cage structure and how people feel somewhat trapped, I think we would really like to use some amount of the money to try and look at what would be at least a cheaper short-term solution to make the cage structure more attractive and feel more open. I don't think the clearing of vegetation, which will have a big impact and helpful, is very expensive, relatively speaking. So maybe there's a hybrid where some part of the money gets spent on making people feel comfortable with the bridge short term, and maybe the remainder gets put towards a long-term solution.
Yeah, because the key is that footbridge, even if it's made fancy and beautiful, doesn't get us any more functionality than what exists today. Okay? When you get to the putting a transit bridge in, that gives us a whole lot more functionality. The more money you get spent on the footbridge, it's less money you spend on our future. And if a whole lot gets spent on the footbridge, the transit bridge is going to go out the window in your terms. So my take is do the minimum necessary to get the footbridge to where Howard Hughes can get its building permit and put the vast majority of the money into let's build a bridge, or let's begin design, let's begin the effort to get the money. The sooner the better, in my opinion.
I wanted to say that I really appreciate the fact that so many county officials are here from different departments. But what's missing to me is when does the Howard County Economic Development Authority get involved? Is there, are we looking at this too narrowly as just a transportation project? Is there money in the economic development?
Good question. Any history?
I don't think they typically have money for capital projects, but there might be something through state, Department of business economic development or talking to local.
I would love to see them at least involved in this discussion and the decision. This is a development issue. It's not just about serving the people who are here now. It's about the people that we want to come here, the people who are not yet here, the people that this project, if done correctly, could attract. And I really would like to see someone from that economic department at least in on the deliberations.
And to add to what Kay's saying, what about community development funding, both at the state level, county level, and maybe even at the federal level, because this is a reinvention of Oakland Mills. This is a community development thing. It is economic development. It is jobs. But that, you know, is there any source of money there as well?
I believe that the funding is, of course, we are involved with the revitalization of Oakland Mills, but I think the funding for a bridge and a transportation transit going to be a lot different than the economic development or redevelopment revitalization of the village center. Certainly part of the discussion, it needs to be, but I think the funding sources are different. But I appreciate your comment, Kay. We definitely get the economic development authority as well as DBED involved in the revitalization effort.
I have a question about the excise tax that Mary Kay brought up a few minutes ago. It's apparently just spent on roadway development in the county. Could that be spent on a transit roadway? And the reason I've written that up is that someone here earlier said that we're never going to build our way out of the highway demand that's facing us. We've got to start looking at other options. And a lot of places have been very successful at beginning to invest more in transit. We all say, well, gee, wouldn't it be great if more people rode transit? Wouldn't it be great if we could get more people on buses or bicycles or whatever? But we rarely do anything specific to make that happen. And this is something that would be specific that could help make that happen because it offers such a tremendous shortcut. It makes the transit trip shorter and therefore more desirable compared to the car trip. And that's the kind of thing, if we're ever going to get people onto buses, we have to start taking real physical steps to do that.
Marcia, can that excise tax be used for that?
Currently, it's drafted as being for roads. However, the adequate public facilities or the task force is meeting now, and that certainly is part of that system. It could be looked at as being broadened, whether that would be broadened, you know, to include transit elsewhere in the county or strictly for downtown. I know we've amended the adequate public facilities testing in downtown to be inclusive of bikes and pedestrians as well as automobiles. So downtown can certainly be treated differently from the rest of the county if we wanted to.
So Marcia, also, just to add on to that, so for full disclosure, if I'm not mistaken, in order to make any changes to how we can use the excise tax, it will be an act of the state legislature. So for our delegates that are still here, Mr. Ebersol, they'll have a part to play based on requests that we may make.
Okay, good point. Thank you. Delegate?
I think relevant to that is, and I'm going to back up just a little bit to be sure, we're sort of at a crossroads here because I'm seeing a slide up here that is going through all the different transit and pedestrian and bicycle ways we're going to get. I'm seeing presentations about interchange involving traffic, and it seems to me, and somebody can correct me if I'm wrong, that Oakland Mills Village Center is really at the crossroads. It looks like if we build an interchange, we create traffic into Oakland Mills, or we seal it off and we don't, and suddenly there's no pedestrian footbridge. I've yet to hear anyone say that we're going to do both somehow or another. And so what concerns me is that Oakland Mills will either in the case of a traffic interchange, we're either going to cut Oakland Mills off or we're going to open it up to sort of being a thoroughfare of sorts. And my bent is that we look for ways to get people on their feet and on bicycles and in mass transit. And so I'm wondering if someone can tell me what is the motivation for us to be building a traffic interchange on 29, which looks like it has a short distance into any of the neighborhoods. We run to a traffic light pretty quickly. I drive on 29 on a regular basis. during rush hour, and I know as soon as you come to any interchange, that is backing up, backs up the road as well. What is our motivation for building a traffic interchange at this location rather than pursuing pedestrian, bicycle, and footbridge? And so, relevant to Councilwoman Singer's comment, I would be happy to try to pursue ways to let that excise tax be used for the other. But if somebody could answer that question for me, I would appreciate that.
I guess that's a real difficult question. I mean, when we look at the interchange, that's looking at the traffic flows and things of that sort. Like I said, I showed four alternatives out of the 10. The one that did show going into Oakland Mills, the other ones really did not. And what they do is they use the existing pedestrian bridge for access. So enhancing this existing pedestrian bridge would provide pedestrian access. As far as transit, currently we do have transit on 175 and also Brooklyn Parkway. So those are the alternatives that are there. But I think that this discussion is really what is going to come up with a possible way to go in the future. I think we're at a point where we have feasibility studies, and I know that. I think this is the first time the interchange has been presented. So I think a lot more discussions need to take place on the interchange. And not just with this community, but the other communities on their side too, to get the full impact of what we really should be doing.
So you are suggesting then that the two could exist together at the same time? Okay.
I think it should.
So, Mr. Ebersole, if I could just take one second, or Ms. Wilson, if I could just take one second for Mr. Ebersole. It was assumed as part of the downtown Columbia plan, and therefore the full build-out, that ultimately, based on our, at least our current adequate public facilities ordinance, that we were in fact going to need another way into and out of downtown. And so, and that was not to, so this is all about multimodal then. Right, so we have to move cars according to our current plan, but we also know that we need to move people in other ways, transit and bike and ped. And so I think it is either a one structure that does all of them, or two structures that do all of them together as well.
So they're not exclusive.
They're not exclusive.
Can I just follow up on that? Are some of the options that are talked about here inconsistent with doing a third interchange?
That's a question for you, John. John, or was any part of the study, did they consider the third interchange?
No, they did not.
Okay.
Well, but I mean, the other way around, like in the third interchange,
highways.
Is there concern that, I mean, maybe there isn't a concern about it because you just you take out a pedestrian bridge if you need to for a third interchange, but I'm wondering if any of all of these could stay if you were doing a third interchange, or if there's some kind of conflict between the two that we really ought to just be talking about.
You would certainly have a conflict with the link options.
What about the other options?
The other options, I believe, could coexist. But there would not be a conflict.
I think because we have two different studies, I think it could be hybridized in the way that if you wanted to take one of the interchange options that has a connection over to, from the third interchange over to Oakland Mills, that could be for automobiles, or it could be just for transit, it could be structured that way, and then whether bike and ped is part of that, or whether it has a separate bike ped in a current location. Again, I think there's different ways of mixing and matching, but again, so much effort into crossing out all the variables that we could decide what we want to do, then maybe trying to pursue moving forward would be.
But Marcia, correct me if I'm wrong, because I'm trying to remember the original studies, the original third interchange studies and pedestrian. I thought that there was some discussion about those being in conflict with the bridge. That the third interchange, there were certain plans for the bridge that would not be consistent with it.
I think, again, unfortunately, I think SHA is all, our MDOT representatives are all gone.
The spacing for crossings over 29 would be, I think, of concern to MDOT. So if we were to have a new bridge, more or less in location of the existing bridge, and new third interchange, so we have essentially two new entities in terms of structures involving 29, they probably would be less likely to be enthused about that.
So I guess that's what I was getting at in terms of us just sort of bringing out an open and having a discussion about whether the part of the issue is a conflict. Because if what you're saying, what I heard you saying, and I could be wrong, but I thought what you were saying is, if you build an existing, if you do take one of the options that works with the existing structure, there's not a conflict. But if you do a new bridge, there is either an actual conflict or a, I'm not sure the word, quasi-conflict, I guess I'd say, in terms of getting approval through SHA. So I just, if those two things are competing, I think we ought to be discussing them together and sort of have an awareness of that.
Let me answer that. I don't know that I have this answer completely for sure, so I'll give you my best guess at the moment. I saw some earlier drawings by Howard Hughes that would have suggested a conflict. But the options that they have presented, that Hogan's presented, do not present a conflict. So it depends on the option that you pick. I'm not going to say that with 100% certainty, but I'm 99.9% there. But I do remember some drawings that were definitely in conflict. These options are not.
Okay, I think they might have been in the published, the study that was used to satisfy the first CEPA that they did. And maybe somebody could take a look at that, because I just want to make sure that we're not worrying about a conflict and that that's pushing us towards using the existing structure. We should be figuring out what our priority is in terms of this bridge with the knowledge of, you know, what other forces are. The other forces are that if we do it in any other location, there's a big cost of it in terms of whether we can do a third interchange. We should at least know that we're talking about that. Mm-hmm.
Yeah, I agree. Yes.
Thanks. The one thing I think that could negate the need for a third interchange is what Mary Kay brought up early on, and that's bus rapid transit, which really would have an effect on the level of college.
Yes, Karen.
That sort of ties in with what I'm saying, with what I was going to say, which is that if we don't have transit on that bridge, then the transit is competing with all the cars. So you're talking about concern about intersections that are failing and all the traffic. And if you have transit, it's running on a transit right-of-way, which Columbia is unique in having such a right-of-way, that negates a lot of those issues. And I think that's one of the reasons why it's so important to have transit on this bridge, because it's not competing with the traffic. It's on a separate route. And I think that that's a really significant point that I don't know it's really being addressed. That was a comment.
For the third interchange build out timeline, what years are we talking about potentially?
Well, I mean, as the state said, I mean, 7 years before it's going to be completed. The project itself, if we had money today, it would probably take 10 to 12 years to implement.
Before we need it?
The need was looking at 2035 and beyond.
So we're looking ballpark for a third interchange with vehicular traffic about 2035.
I would say 2035.
So we're looking 20 years down the road.
Yes.
Okay. So there, to me, says, hey, separate the two, the third interchange from all discussion, because it's 20 years out into the future. There's a need for transit now and could greatly enhance life here in Columbia and the county. So to me, timeline, they're so separated timeline-wise, they don't come into the same discussion.
Okay, thank you.
anybody else have any comments or questions? We've learned a lot here today. It's been a great conversation. We have a lot of information to digest. And I hope everyone here has signed in. We'll be going back and putting some information together to go out. We'll be talking to the stakeholders and figuring out where we go from here. I think that the point was very well taken, that certainly the timeline discussion and funding, and funding is available, and they compete. So we'll be getting in touch with everybody. John, one final comment?
The comment that I would give, hearing the schedule from MDOT, that they're coming in the fall for a tour, I think we ought to have a schedule that we're well ahead of the curve, and that no later than mid-August we have a solution on which direction we want to at least think we're proceeding. And I think a plan of attack on how we deal with MDOT and their selection criteria, I think we break their list. We certainly take the majority of what I saw on their list of criteria. And I think we need to be banging the drum for environmental and sustainability issues for the health of our citizens here in Columbia, because I think that bridge can do quite a bit. And I'd like to know, since I'm not here, I'll ask it anyway, but the makeup of the jury that is reviewing the criteria, and how many engineers are on the list versus others, and how many advocates for sustainability are participating. I think the idea of the Oakland Mills development plays into this as a big factor. And I think the question of whether to bring cars into or not is a real good question. But the solution is so far out that we need to separate the discussion and say, all right, let's deal with the cars in and out is one issue, because it's going to take at least 2035 to have any kind of solution. And let's focus on the bridge. How do we bring transit and pedestrian priorities up to the front burner?
Yeah, I wanted to agree with that, but I also wanted to clarify something. I wasn't suggesting that we hold the pedestrian issues to third interchange at all. I just want us to know that if there's factors that are weighing into how the county looks at building a pedestrian bridge, we should be aware of what that cost benefit analysis is. But I absolutely agree with John that it is. But that is so far down the line that we really ought to be prioritizing pedestrian transit bridge. So just
I'd like to thank everybody for participating. I especially would like to thank our team members, Sandy Schrader and Carl DiLorenzo, Phil Nichols, and Andy Bynoon, as well as the other members of the administration who are made time available on their schedule to be here. And certainly appreciate all the community coming, the elected officials that are here. Thank you very much. And thanks for a successful morning, and we will be in touch. Thank you.